Hi, I'm Arizona Attorney General Terry Goddard. The manufacture of methamphetamines is a very serious public safety problem in Arizona. These illegal drug labs are operated by and set up by persons, often drug addicts, who usually have no knowledge at all of chemistry or the dangers posed by mixing hazardous toxic chemicals. Even worse, many of these meth labs are found in homes, apartments, or hotels where children are present. From 2000 to 2003, there were 1,177 methamphetamine lab-related seizures made by law enforcement in Arizona, generating almost 1,400 arrests. During this same four-year period, 322 children were rescued at the meth lab sites. Disposal costs for contamination associated with meth labs was more than $3 million during this period. The Drug Endangered Children program model provides a framework for cooperation between prosecutors, law enforcement, child protective services, medical professionals, fire departments, and environmental professionals.
The Drug Endangered Children Program, DEC as we call it, is part of the State Attorney General's effort to prosecute crimes in our state involving the use and illegal manufacture of drugs, primarily methamphetamine. We have a drug prosecution unit at the Attorney General's office that prosecutes cases that are investigated by the High Intensity Drug Trafficking Task Force. Some years ago, we perceived a burgeoning number of cases that involved the investigation of the manufacture of methamphetamine in homes and apartments in our community where children were living. We identified special social and legal aspects of those cases that involved children and the manufacture of drugs. We tried to identify appropriate means to address those special needs. In year 2000, we looked to the state of California to a program that was being utilized there to enhance the investigation and prosecution of crimes that involved the manufacture of methamphetamine in locations where children were present. We formulated a protocol to assist us in the investigation and prosecution of these cases. Since the DEC program began, we have prosecuted over 114 cases involving over 241 victims. In our DEC program, we have partners, and we attribute our success of the DEC program in large part to the cooperation of those partners. The partners include the Arizona Department of Public Safety, local law enforcement agencies, the Department of Economic Security and its Child Protective Services Division, the Child Help Child Advocacy Center, St. Joseph's Hospital, local fire departments, and the Arizona Department of Environmental Quality. We are very pleased to say that the program we developed in Maricopa County has been adopted for use in rural counties. Most recently, Pinal County established a program of its own using ours as a model, but it is specifically adapted to the needs of the rural communities in Pinal County.
As we look at the ingredients on the table, why don't we take a moment and focus on the three primary ingredients that go into making methamphetamine. Let's start with the pseudoephedrine. You cannot make methamphetamine without the pseudoephedrine. And pseudoephedrine comes in a variety of different brands and types. Nearly all of it will work in the manufacturing process. And the pseudoephedrine comes in pill form in binder. And some of the binders are clear, some of the binders are red. And that's relevant because that influences the color of the final product. So, as you can see, this is quite a bit of pseudoephedrine. When you're in a home and you come across a medicine cabinet or a location within the home where there's a significant amount of antihistamine or cold medicine or items of this nature, you've got to ask yourself, why would they have that much? So that's a key ingredient. Another key ingredient is red phosphorus. The majority of the meth cooks in Arizona get their red phosphorus from striker plates on flares or from matchboxes. So when you come across flares and the striker plates are torn off, or when you come across something similar to what you see here, a lot of matches where the tips have not been burned, yet the striker plates are all removed, that's an indication that somebody's trying to get the red phosphorus. This is not something that you see in a normal household, yet it's very common in a home where meth's being manufactured. So we talked about the pseudoephedrine, we talked about the red phosphorus. The other item, the third item that's a key component, is iodine. This is a 1 pound container of crystal iodine. The majority of the iodine that we find left behind at meth sites is purchased at local tack and feed stores. This is probably a little larger than what you'd find at most stores. It's not uncommon to see in 2 and 4 ounce glass vials. And we do the best we can with some of the recent legislation to control the type of people and the type of quantities that can come in and buy iodine. As we seek stronger control on the sale and the trafficking of crystal iodine, we found that the meth manufacturers have gotten creative. And one example of their creativity is how they have discovered you can combine hydrogen peroxide with liquid iodine, 7% tincture iodine, a lot like the methylate that we used to put on our sores when we were younger. And they found that by combining these two substances, you can actually create crystallized iodine and use it in the meth manufacturing process. We're very fortunate in Arizona that we have a very strong drug endangered children program. And the strength of that program lies in the commitment and the partnership that exists between everybody that's involved in the welfare of kids.
I investigate the child abuse that occurs inside meth labs. The most common thing that you see is the houses are usually neglected, they're filthy. Oftentimes there's no food in the refrigerators. If there is food, it's rotting. The priority in the household seems to be focused around the drugs, as well as them using the stoves and refrigerators to produce their methamphetamine. So they're using the same appliances to cook the meth as well as to cook the food for the children. And what we actually find is we find pipe bombs often. We find a lot of arsenals. They're usually always loaded and they're always in a proximity of where the children are. The first step I do is ensure that CPS is aware that we have children in a meth lab and they will respond with me. What I will do is walk through the scene and establish the hazards specifically to the children. Not the narcotics, but what dangers are there to the children. And oftentimes I'll find things like chemicals sitting in regular glassware that children will actually drink. I'll find chemicals hidden in the children's belongings. The Phoenix Police Department Child Crimes Unit is actually co-located with the Child Help Center. Also co-located here is Child Protective Services and an advocacy center that strictly deals with the crisis intervention for the children. The unique thing about the meth labs is we also have doctors on staff from St. Joe's Hospital. And when we remove a child from a meth lab, they're brought here to the center. They're decontaminated by bathing them, given a new set of clothes. They're examined by a doctor, and then CPS will make a determination on where that child should be placed. So the Child Help Center actually facilitates a one-stop for that child.
When we first came to the table for the collaboration, we were apprehensive as far as what our role would be. We were concerned about our worker safety as far as being in the vicinity of the meth lab and the arrest of the parents. When we started the program and we got more into it, the training came about, we became more educated in the process. Law enforcement basically was a great partner. They made sure that we were away from the scene and out of any danger prior to entering the home. I think what it's done for us and law enforcement, it certainly has strengthened our relationship and actually made it more of a partnership versus an us versus them.
There are a lot of different chemicals that are used that are biohazard chemicals. They're very hazardous chemicals, and children come into contact with those. For example, iodine can be very toxic when it's in high doses. Red phosphorus is very, very dangerous for children. So the proximity of the child to the lab, the exposure of the child to the chemicals, if the chemicals are kept in the refrigerator in soda bottles, children may drink them. These homes tend to blow up. Children can get burns from either fires or from caustic chemicals. And they can be exposed to the airborne methamphetamine or products that are used in the preparation of methamphetamine, develop respiratory problems. Long term, there's a real concern about liver damage, kidney damage, cancer-causing chemicals. They have been pulled out of a meth lab during a raid, and they've seen their parents handcuffed and taken away or whatever they do with their parents. And so many of these children are absolutely terrified when they come in here. The first thing that's done, again, is decontamination of the child, or that is cleaning the child and changing their clothes. I do a general, complete pediatric examination, and that includes measuring height, weight, head circumference if it's a younger child. We measure things like reach. We have the child reach as high as they can, and that's important because it can help establish risks to the child in the home. For example, if there's a weapon on a dresser and the child can reach the weapon, then it's considered dangerous. We do a very careful physical examination, paying particular attention to respiratory status, to cardiac status, and to neurologic status. These children are also considered at very high risk of physical or sexual abuse as well as neglect. We do look for any signs of injury.
The role of the DEC prosecutor in the multidisciplinary program is to prosecute the criminal cases that arise from a DEC investigation. And it's the prosecutor's job to pursue these cases vigorously in the interests of justice for these children. When a child is discovered in a methamphetamine lab, the Attorney General's office vigorously prosecutes child abuse charges as well as the manufacture of dangerous drug charges. However, this office strongly pursues cases where children are exposed to the drug element generally. We refer to those cases as level 2 cases. The level 1 cases are the methamphetamine lab cases where children live. The level 2 cases are those other environments where neglect and abuse and the exposure to items of paraphernalia, the drugs themselves, are present, even when the lab isn't. A drug endangered child is a child who is exposed to an environment where meth is being produced, or exposed to an environment where drugs are being used or sold or transported. It can be in a vehicle, it could be outside. A drug endangered child can be endangered anywhere. Predominantly, we find the children in methamphetamine labs in the homes where they live. Many times, the Attorney General's office becomes involved after the investigation has concluded. We receive reports from investigators from both CPS and the police departments involved in the investigation. And we receive scientific reports from the crime lab outlining what they found. Often, the crime lab will test things like teddy bears and children's toys rather than the traditional items comprising the meth lab, in order to support the child abuse charges. We then take all the information we get from all the respective investigating groups, and the Attorney General's office presents the case in court. In the criminal Superior Court case, we pursue all the criminal charges, the child abuse, the methamphetamine manufacture, the drug charges. And in juvenile court, we pursue the dependency case. In July 2003, Arizona enacted the meth lab cleanup law, referred to as the remediation law. It is now mandatory in Arizona that meth labs be cleaned up by certified remediation firms, and only the owner of the property may enter. It is a Class 6 felony to enter the property if you are anyone other than the true owner. The benefit of this new law is that the children taken out of these meth lab homes will not be able to return to those homes until they have been cleaned up based on very strict standards. There's two kinds of contamination in Arizona. The gross contamination, which are the components of the lab itself, predominantly, and the drugs and things along those lines. But there's also the residual contamination, where sometimes historically families have moved into homes that were meth lab sites and gotten ill from the fumes and the iodines permeating through drywall, which always remained behind, even though a cleanup effort was made in the past. As the prosecutor here at the Arizona Attorney General's office, assigned to the DEC program, I have a dual role. On the one hand, I prosecute a methamphetamine lab caseload predominantly involving children. And on the other hand, I coordinate our training component. The training component for the Arizona DEC program consists of typically 5 individuals who present an all-day long training that's worth credit for law enforcement officers, attorneys, and medical doctors. The training component involves a drug crime detective, a child crime detective, a crime lab chemist, a pediatrician specializing in forensics and child abuse, and the role of the prosecutor. In the last several years, well over 1,000 individuals have received training in the Arizona Multidisciplinary Protocol and the effects of methamphetamine on children generally. The audience is predominantly comprised of CPS professionals, law enforcement officers, medical professionals, and prosecuting attorneys. We know that methamphetamine and methamphetamine labs affect every community in Arizona. And our goal is statewide implementation of the DEC protocol.
The Attorney General's Office is working to provide technical assistance and training to teams of law enforcement, child protective services, medical professionals, fire departments, environmental professionals, and others interested in participating in the Drug Endangered Children program. To get involved or for more information, please contact my office.